Sir Frederick called me. He was unable to attend the funeral. And he said, I heard you today. It was a good sermon. I thought by then I had learned my lesson from the late Eileen Williams, the wife of the late Henry Williams, who for several years was reminding me that I had to preach at her funeral. And in her own special way, she would say to me, and don't be long, or else I will come up there and pull you down. Well, I hope I have truly learned my lesson at this time. My dear friends and brothers and sisters all, if ever there was an occasion to borrow the well-loved words of Shakespeare, written for his star character, Mark Antony, to eulogize his friend Julius Caesar, it is now. This is what Shakespeare wrote. He acted from honesty and for the general good. His life was gentle, and the elements mixed so well in him that nature might stand up and say to all the world, this was a man. Unquote. It was my privilege and honor to know Frederick Ballantyne for close to four decades and to be numbered among his friends. He began to prepare me for my role today sometime in the latter half of 2018, when quite untypically he said to me, I am delegating you to preach at my funeral. I said, that's not going to be now, no. That's not going to be now, man. There is much time for that. He said, how about next year? Which was 2019. And he gave me the diagnosis. It has been a wonderful journey, a great experience for me as I interacted frankly and seriously, as always, with my friend about life and about God. For his family, close and trusted friends, and those who cared for him so lovingly during the period of his illness, the last several weeks of his life in particular were seasoned with much blessing. As he lived, so he died. A humble, caring, appreciative, gentle, unpretentious soul with a delightful sense of humor, always concerned about the well-being of others and not so much about himself. Today, his family consider themselves to be specially blessed to have had this wonderful human being in their lives. And they rejoice in the assurance that he is at peace with God, that it is well with his soul, is a conviction shared by all who had the privilege to interact with him in recent times and to minister to him during his illness. All the hymns on this funeral program. His Eyes on the Sparrow, sung by Beth, and the Hallelujah chorus we heard so well from the combined choir a while ago, were chosen by him. Hear this. And I quote, "Be aware and accommodating of mental change, depression, frustration, irrelevant and inappropriate utterances. Always remember that I am always grateful for your support." Unquote. That is the text of the final paragraph of a document he composed several weeks ago for the guidance of his family as he prepared them for the challenging responsibility of caring for him. And so, my brothers and sisters and friends, my close observations of this outstanding, humble giant over many years and up to the time of his passing compels me to lift up for consideration today the powerful advice offered in the first two verses of the 12th chapter of the New Testament book of Hebrews. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. The cloud of witnesses to whom the author refers are the saints above. We know that. But who are the saints? The 17th century hymn writer Isaac Watts begins one of his hymns with the petition, quote, "Give me the wings of faith to rise within the veil and see the saints above. How great their joys, how bright their glories be." And he continues, "Once they were mourners here below, they wrestled hard, as we do now, with sins and doubts and fears." That is Isaac Watts's description, so to speak, of the saints. During my interactions with my friend, over these last several months in particular, I became intensely curious about saints. Every time I spoke to him, every time we have a discussion, we spoke about saints. Consequently, I read all, yes, literally, all the references to saints in the Bible. I read everything I have in my study relating to saints, some of which I have had for decades but never paid any serious attention to, including a publication on the Confessions of Saint Augustine. The result, my friends, is an overwhelming conviction that saints are everyday people, always in our midst, and some of them very close to us. But we fail to recognize and appreciate them because somehow our knowledge and understanding of saints is limited or has become blurred by the urgent issues with which we must so often contend. It has become clear to me, and maybe this is what my friend was pointing me to, it has become clear, crystal clear to me, that saints are not too heavenly minded to truly live in the here and now and to become practically involved in business and in politics and in pleasure. One of the treasures that I unearthed during my search is a book by the late American poet Phyllis McGinley, published in 1969, titled Saint Watching. Miss McGinley was fascinated with saints, not because they were pious and sanctimonious or lived in convents or monasteries or were hermits, but because she found them to be diverse, lively, and exciting people. She says, and I quote again, "The wonderful thing about saints is that they are human." They lost their tempers. They scolded God. Were egotistical or testy or impatient in their turns. They made mistakes and regretted them. Still, however, they went on doggedly blundering toward heaven. Unquote. Saints are people just like you and me and Freddy. Miss McGinley continues. She says, like musicians and painters and poets, saints are human beings, but obsessed ones. They are obsessed by goodness and by God, as Michelangelo was possessed by line and form, as Shakespeare was bewitched by language, Beethoven by song, and like other geniuses, they use mortal means to contrive their masterpieces. Unquote. What are their masterpieces? According to another great preacher, theologian, American clergyman, William Sloane Coffin, their masterpieces are their lives. Their masterpieces are their lives. Their lives are the miracle. All else is commentary. My friends, the lives of the saints are uniquely different from ours because they have bigger, stronger hearts. Their hearts can withstand the pain and the hurt of disappointment, the pain and the hurt brought on by hate and envy and malice and betrayal, selfishness, and all the other things that nibble away at their good intentions, question their sincerity, and sometimes insult their kindness. Saints take the central imperative of the gospel literally. They feed the hungry. They clothe the naked. They give to the poor. They care for the sick. They return good for evil. They love God, and they love their neighbor as Christ loves them. Aye, they know what love is. They believe in love. We heard it said by Marcus earlier. They believe in love. They live to love. I don't know that I've met a more loving, caring family in my life. You can't imagine what this experience has done for me over these last several months as I watch you care and interact, as I watch his friends come in from thousands of miles away. Thousands of miles away to see him and to spend time with him. Hassan was here last Wednesday. He left in the afternoon to go back to Germany to see after his sick brother. Freddie died on Thursday. He is here today again from Turkey. They know how to love and how to teach love. You are living examples of that. Saints are conquerors because they realize from experience that it is not those who can inflict the most, but those who can suffer the most, who conquer the world. As one of them puts it so eloquently, love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. However, not uncommonly, alongside great strengths, we find great weaknesses. But the admirable fact is that saints are not unaware of their weaknesses and their shortcomings and their failings. Saints are open and honest with God about their frequent lapses. They do not excuse themselves, and they find it difficult on that basis to excuse others. So that one of them, namesake of Freddie, Nathan, despite the danger, despite what might have happened to him, he went to King David, the great David, who the Bible describes as a man after God's own heart. He went and he challenged him about what happened with Bathsheba and her husband. And when David asked, "Who is this person?" he looked him in the eye and he said, "Thou art the man." Unafraid, they are talking about judging people by your own standards. Read the Confessions of Saint Augustine. They are instructively interesting. And so, in the preceding chapter, or the chapter preceding the one from which our text comes, and which is often described as the honor roll, the hall of fame, the Westminster Abbey of our religion, the Hebrew writer lists the great saints of God's people in the ages before Christ. They had their faults and their failings. And the Bible records these very honestly. Talk about a great balanced book. Records the feats as well as the failings. Very, very, very honestly. But these people lived in faith and put their whole trust in the one true living God of this universe. And then, in the words of the text, the writer turns to us. He turns to us, all of us, with the challenge that I'm inspired by the example of Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne to throw out to you today. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that clings to us so closely, and run with patience and perseverance the race that is set before us, and which we are obliged to run. The track for the race on which we are embarked, my friends, is like an obstacle course designed by the King of Evil himself. It is covered with traps and hurdles, and it takes strength of character. Yes, it calls for the discarding of excess baggage, the things and attitudes that inhibit our upward and forward movement as we fix our gaze on Jesus, our perfect and ultimate example. But we note, as we conclude, my friends, that we take this journey of our lives in the presence of a great number of unseen observers. Are you aware of their presence? Could you see them? Do you recognize any of them? Do you remember their story? They are the people who touched our lives and helped mold and shape us. They are the ones who, in similar circumstances as ours, endeavored to be practical examples of what they believed. By God, they are our parents, our grandparents, our children, our spouses, our siblings, and others we once knew here on earth. And Frederick, Freddy, Daddy, Dr. B, Chief, Governor General Ballantyne has now joined them. Their desire is for us to admirably finish the race, just as they have done. They are saying to us, we have run that race before you. At one time we were where you are now. We finished well, and we are confident that you too could finish well and even do better than we have done. Dr. Ballantyne is saying to us especially, be careful. Be careful that you are aware also of the mortal who run with you every day. They have much to teach you. Learn from their example. Be carefully observant, because you could easily miss some of them. Some of them are simple, humble folk, performing regular, sometimes ordinary jobs, and again I quote Marcus a while ago, but in extraordinary ways. simple, ordinary people. The maids and the gardeners and the little people in our offices, the painter and others, without whose work and dedication, without whose love and affection, without whose security, we cannot continue to exist. Freddie Ballantyne recognized all of them. You should hear them, and you must have heard the many who have called in since his departure to testify of his kindness and his goodness to them. He was a people's helper, and he would say to you, boy, you have to recognize these people, because without them, you ain't got nowhere to go, no matter how high you climb. And if I may say it, Sir James, I always recall, I learn a lot. And one day, I was sitting in Barbados, outside, waiting for a flight, going somewhere, and then I felt somebody touch me on the shoulder. I wasn't a speaker or anything yet, but he knew me, Sir James, young man. Touched me on my shoulder. And when I looked up, it was the Prime Minister. So I got up, and he stayed there with me, and he said, come, go into the VIP place with me. Come on. He took me in. And when I left for my flight, I said, sir, I thank you so much. I mean, as Prime Minister, you are such a humble man. And I always remember what he said to me. He said, you see, my young friend, you have to make sure that you take care of the people on the way up, because it's the same people you're going to meet on the way down. Always remember that, sir. And I'm not afraid to say it today. Freddie Ballantyne was one such man. Yes. Sir Frederick, Freddie, Daddy, Dr. B, Chief, whatever you call him, is now in the pavilion cheering us on. Are you hearing him, Melissa? Are you seeing him? Lauren? Adam? Emma? Beth? Michelle? James? You see him? Ah, Lady B, look at the smile. Yes, you see him? He has joined them, cheering us on. And so, today, as we bless God for the saintly example of Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne and the powerful, inspiring legacy that he has left us, I pray that when at the end of this service we recess with the song, "When the Saints Go Marching In," Lord, I want to be in that number, that we will take the petition expressed seriously and resolve to live our lives in whatever station we find ourselves, to live our lives in such a way that we will be considered worthy to be numbered among the marching saints. God bless you all, and God bless the soul of our brother. Amen.
And I'm sure you can appreciate the next hymn being "For All the Saints Who From Their Labor Rest." We stand and sing together.
the saints who from their labor rest. Only my faith the Lord confessed. My name, O Jesus, be forever blessed.
Amen, amen. And we remain standing and we share in the words of the Apostles' Creed as we reaffirm some fundamental statements of our faith as a community of faith, as a Christian community together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried, descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead, ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he came to the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God and Heavenly Father, as we gather in worship today, we acknowledge you as the source of all that we have and are, your Father. We acknowledge you as the one who demonstrated his love for us through his Son Jesus Christ, enabling us to be able to say and remember, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. You are that God who promise never to leave us alone. Your word says that you will send another comforter. And so, by the very presence of the Holy Spirit, we are assured that whatever challenges we are confronted with, whatever problems we are faced with, we are not alone. In fact, we are reminded, because your Spirit is present with us, that you will never leave us nor forsake us. And so, God, today as we gather in worship, we praise and bless your name for our brother whom we today lay to rest. God, we thank you for the joy and the blessing that his life has brought to others. We thank you for his service to his generation according to your will. And we thank you for the many wonderful memories that we will have and many will have about and of his life. But even now, O God, as we say farewell, even now as we say thanks for your gracious giving to us, we pray that this time of farewell would also be a time of reflection. We pray, dear God, that in this time of farewell that it will minister to us, even as the hymn writer was ministered to when he lost his family, that in reflecting on death, that we will be able to say, when peace, like a river, attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul, it is well. God, we pray that even as we give you thanks for our brother, and even as we say farewell, that this would be a time for us when we to consider this critical question: is it well with my soul? And so, dear God, we bless you for your goodness and mercy that followed our brother all the days of his life. And so even now that the trials of this world are over and death has come, we pray that you will receive him in your perfect kingdom, that he so have lived, O God, to hear you say, well done, good and faithful servant. And even more so for those of us who are still alive, may we so live, not just to make bland and empty platitudes that we will meet again, but that we will so live that we can honestly anticipate by trusting in you, well done, thou good and faithful servant. And so, dear God and Heavenly Father,
We thank you. We trust you. And with the songwriter, we could say we praise you for what is past. And we trust you for what is to come. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. After the commendation, we will sing the Lord's Prayer together. And during the singing of the Lord's Prayer, a nice family prayer, as it were, we are going to ask if the family could just come around the casket, and as we also encourage them in times like these, it is always so important for families to be a source of strength and encouragement to one another. And more than anything else, in times like these, we need a savior, we need an anchor. So be very sure your anchor holds and grips the solid rock. The commendation. Eternal God, you have made us all, and you hate nothing that you have made. You gave your Son, Jesus Christ, for our redemption. And so we commend our brother, Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne, into your perfect mercy and wisdom. And our prayer and desire is that eternal rest you will grant unto him, and let your light perpetual shine upon him. We sing the Lord's Prayer together, and we just want to invite the family to hold hands around the coffin.
Oh, Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. It is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Come on, church, for thine,
for thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Amen.
Family remains there for a moment. Gracious God and Heavenly Father, we lift up this family to you at this time and pray, dear God, that they will be one in you and through you. We pray that they will look to you and depend upon you to daily provide their needs. We pray, dear God, that this time will be a season of their life that not only brings them closer to each other, but even more importantly, brings them closer to you. Bless them, O God, we pray, and strengthen them now, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And brothers and sisters, as we have been worshiping together, what a wonderful way to sing our way to the end of this time in worship. And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Savior's love? Died he for me who caused this pain, for me who him to death pursued. And I'm sure we are going to sing it with gusto, and we are going to really make this church vibrate with the zeal, enthusiasm, and fervor of our singing. Amen?
Amen?
Amen? I thought we would have gotten a much more vociferous amen than that. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. And so let's sing to the glory of God. And can it be, and we end strong. Bold I approach the eternal throne and claim the crown through Christ my own. Amazing love. How can it that thou, my God, died for me? Amazing love. How can it be that thou, my God, should die for me? 'Tis mystery all. Immortal dies, who can explore its strange design? It been the first one set of tries to sound the depths of love. Be this mercy all, let the God do, let me find. This mercy, oh, let earth and let angels' minds inquire no more. He left his father's throne up, so free, so infinite. He's emptied himself of all. For Adam's helpless, 'tis mercy all immense. And oh my God, found a way. 'Tis mercy all immense and free. For my God, it found out me. My presence and spirit has bound in sin and in sin. And I impose a quickening ring. My chains fell off, my heart won. And followed him, my chains fell off, my heart was, I rose, all on him. No condemnation, no condemnation, now I dread Jesus and all in him. What a wonderful thing when we can approach boldly and claim the crown through Christ, our own. Hallelujah. Let us pray. And now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make us perfect in every good thing to do his will, working in us that which is well pleasing in his sight. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. And we sing, when the saints go marching in, when the saints. Oh, when the saints go marching in, oh, when the saints go marching in, I would like to be in that number when the saints go marching in. Oh, when the saints, oh, when the saints go marching in, go marching in. Oh, when the saints go marching in, I would be in that number. When the saints go marching, oh, when the saints, oh, when the go marching in, marching, oh, when the saints go marching in, I would like to be in that number. When the saints go marching, oh, when the saints, oh, go marching in, oh, when the saints, oh, when the saints go marching in, I would like to be in that number.
And so it is a packed, extremely packed Kingstown Methodist Church. People from all walks of life, all strata of the society, have in fact gathered to pay their last respects to Sir Frederick N. Ballantyne, gentlemen who served this country well. St. Vincent and the Grenadines has truly lost a national treasure, a man who contributed to the development of this country in so many ways. He was a philanthropist, a medical doctor. He was a humanitarian of the highest order. And above all, he was a very simple man whose voice really went above a whisper. St. Vincent and the Grenadines says, thank you for your service. And we do hope and know that you will rest in peace. The body leaves the church, headed to its final destination, the casket, which by his request was made by breadfruit wood, something that he wanted, and his family acceded to this wish. Another demonstration of the measure of the man that was Sir Frederick Ballantyne. Of course, our coverage continues. Colvin Harry is on standby outside the church as the hearse will proceed from the church to the Kingstown Cemetery, where his final remains will be laid to rest. Colvin, are you ready? Well, I'm not sure. Are you ready? Are you there? As we await Colvin's participation in the remainder of our broadcast, of course, we will be taking you down to the Kingstown Cemetery. Colvin will follow the proceedings. and we'll let you know exactly what's happening. But right now, the huge crowd, the body has already been placed in the hearse. People are a bit stuck inside due to the fact that some rain. Okay, there you go, there you go.
With the procession that will be moving at slow time, I believe, for a start, and then eventually at quick time, as it did from the assembly chamber into the Kingstown Cemetery. We continue with coverage there on the final portion of this event, the state funeral of Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne. And if you hear a few crackles in between, it's the sound of raindrops hitting an umbrella that's providing a bit of a shelter from the drizzle at the moment. The rain once again seems to be a threat in terms of the procession down to the Kingstown Cemetery, but as it is now, preparations are being made for the movement of the procession. A very fitting funeral service, a fitting tribute to a man who served this country very well. The medical field, he was a cardiologist by profession, a medical doctor. And beyond that, he served as the Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines for 17 consecutive years, and only had to demit office for the purpose of health, for health reasons. And as we have a slight moving forward of the procession at the moment, we get ready for the movement of the procession down to the Kingstown Cemetery. As with the transfer of the body from the Assembly Hall to the Kingstown Methodist Church, we had many persons gathered alongside the road on both sides to have a look and to take their cell phone photos and little videos, just to preserve a moment, the final moment of Sir Frederick on earth. And his earthly remains will be interred in the coming hour at the Kingstown Cemetery. We expect the diversion of traffic in some points as well to facilitate the procession down to the Kingstown Cemetery. Along the way, persons who didn't get the time off from work, not all business places, unfortunately, observe the half holiday that was given. It was applied specifically for the public sector workers, statutory bodies, and schools, institutions, etc. However, some private entities took the decision to fall in line with the government's declaration of a half holiday for public servants, and some continued with business until their usual closing time. We see persons, many of whom are dressed in their work outfits, coming straight from work or sticking around after finishing their work duties for the day, just to have a look at the final procession, final movement of the mortal remains of Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne, former Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines. Of course, this is a state funeral, and the highest accord being given to Sir Frederick for his excellent contribution as a nation builder, a statesman, a medical doctor, a friend to many, and I would venture to say an enemy to few. He touched many persons, you know, in so many different ways. You heard the heartfelt condolences and the teary tributes that were shared on our platforms, on our Facebook page, and also on our call-in programs and otherwise. And we know that it is a man that will be missed for his contribution. And it's interesting to note, as we live streamed our event here today, we were going through the comments just to see what persons are saying, and it was nothing but high praises for the work that he did on earth, and for the lives that he touched, and for the many things that he did for persons. Persons took the opportunity to type out paragraphs upon paragraphs of how he touched them individually and how he made their lives so much better during his time as a medical doctor. Of course, the World Pediatric Project is greatly attributed to his work and his time as a medical doctor. He spent a considerable amount of time helping people, not just because he was a doctor, but because he genuinely cared about the welfare of his people. Having served at the highest post in the land as Governor General, the Queen's representative, Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II, and he was knighted and accorded the GCMG insignia to his name, along with him being an MD, a medical doctor. Hence, from time to time, and during the course of the last few days in our newscasts and otherwise, you'd hear the reference to him, or that accreditation being added to his name. But this is because of his knighthood, being knighted by the Queen herself in November of 2002, just I believe weeks after he became the Governor General, effectively replacing Sir Charles Antrobus, who passed away earlier in 2002. As we get ready to move with the procession, we can see some movements in the back. You can hear in the distance the slow march begin from the Royal St. Vincent and the Grenadines Police Force band, and that is a note that we will have a movement of the procession now. The procession is pretty much moving at the moment, and in just a few moments we will be at full clip down to the Kingstown Methodist Church. So as we continue with the coverage, we hope that you who are viewing, those of you who are viewing by way of Facebook Live, by way of SVG Television as well, that you, and also by VC3, you have the front row seat to what is happening. We may not have the visual from above, unfortunately. You know, there's some ongoing drizzles, and we wouldn't want to have any issues with our equipment, so, but we'll of course have the camera movements on the ground from our technical team, along with the radio coverage. all the way down to the Kingstown Methodist Church. We can hear persons singing along. We can hear the band moving closer and closer. The Outriders sporting their very rarely seen helmets. I was told the actual name of it, but I actually am not able to recall the name, but it's a rare sighting that you see members of the Royal St. Vincent and the Grenadines Police Force, and this, an occasion such as this, you will see them sporting this particular type of hat. As we hear the police band moving forward, we know that many persons will be depending on us for the continued coverage, and we will continue with the coverage on NBC and on the other entities that are joining us now. I do know that we have Star Radio joining us as well. Hopefully we still have SVG Television with us, and also VC3 Television relaying our live video and audio feed. But as the procession moves down to the Kingstown Cemetery, in the distance we see the rain once again appearing, and we do hope that that will of course not present a major challenge to the onward movement of the parade, the procession rather. Persons looking out of the buildings, of those that are lying on the streets, some standing under the arches and the galleries, workmen atop buildings looking down, persons looking through their various workplace windows, just to get a glance of what is happening and to witness firsthand a state funeral that has been afforded for Sir Frederick Nathaniel Valentine, former Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines. Served from 2002 until demitting office in 2019 due to health reasons. A quick time march beginning now. We hear in the distance the police force band moving up quickly with their quick time march, and that will continue for some time. And as we move closer and closer to the Kingstown Cemetery, of course we will continue to bring you the coverage here on NBC Radio and all other platforms that are with us. We will make sure that, of course, we have the...
Instructions. I'm just following instructions. Thank you. brothers and sisters, we could. We know, according to God's word, that neither death nor life, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. We know that if this earthly house of our tabernacle, physical, be dissolved, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Since our brother has departed out of this life, and Almighty God, in his mercy and wisdom, has taken him to himself, we therefore commit his body to the ground, dust to dust, ashes to ashes, and earth to earth, in the sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life.
Vincent and the Grenadines. Served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Deakin, who had been interim Governor General after the death of Sir Charles Andrews. Today we remember him as a man of great humility as he is laid to rest.
Jordan Road. Road Jordan Road. Road Jordan Road. Jordan Road. Oh, I want to get to heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan roll.
My brother, you ought to bend there. Yes, my Lord.
The late Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne,
the
Governor-General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines. Served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Dacre, who had been interim Governor General after the death of Sir Charles Antrobus. Today we remember him as a man of great humility as he was laid to rest.
Mortality as human beings. We must never forget. Young die and old die. Intelligent die and less informed die. Medical doctors who understand the anatomy die, and people who don't know anything about this mortal body die. We all die. My hope always is when we get to moments like these, it reminds us at whatever we accumulate, whatever we do in this world, we must never forget that one day we will die. And I pray that we will take heed of the little adage of the older folks: it is what we do for God that will last. I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, from henceforth, even so says the Spirit, for the rest from their labors. Let us go to God in prayer.
Our Lord.
O Lord, all the day long of this turbulous life, until the shadows lengthen, the evening comes, the busy world is hushed, the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Yeah. Then, Lord, in your mercy, grant unto us safe lodging, holy rest and peace at the last. Through Christ Jesus, our Lord.
Amen. Amen. And may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. Amen. The family could drop the roses at this time, and then we will sing together, How Great Thou Art, and the police band would lead us in our singing at this time. Consider all the world thy hands have made.
the late Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne, former Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Dacre, who had been interim Governor General after the death of Sir Charles Angelos. Today we remember him as a man of great humility as he is laid to rest.
Jordan Road, Road, Jordan Road. Jordan Road, oh, I want to get to heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan Road. My brother, you ought to bend there, yes, my Lord.
The late Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne,
the
Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Dacre, who had been interim Governor General after the death of Sir Charles Antrobus. Today we remember him as a man of great humility as he was laid to rest.
Jordan, Road, oh, I want to get you heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan Road. My mother, you ought to bend there, yes, my Lord. The city in the kingdom, to see old Jordan Road, Road, Jordan Road, Jordan Road, Jordan Road. Oh, I want to get to heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan Road. Oh, I want to get to heaven when I die, to see old Jordan Road. Road.
The late Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne, former Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Dacre, who had been interim Governor General after the death of Sir Charles Angelos.
Road,
the late Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne, former Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Dacre, who had been interim Governor General after the death of Sir Charles Angelos. Today we remember him as a man of great humility as he is laid to rest.
Thank you.
Reverend Nathaniel Valentine, former Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Dagan, who had been interim Governor General after the death of Sir Charles Angelus. Today we remember him as a man of great humility as he is laid to rest.
Jordan Road. Jordan Road. Jordan Road. Oh, I want to get to heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan Road. My brother, you ought to been there. Yes, my Lord.
The late Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne,
the
Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Dacon, who had been interim Governor General after the death of Sir Charles Antrobus. Today we remember him as a man of great humility as he was laid to rest.
Oh, I want to get you heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan Road. My mother, you ought to been there. Yes, my Lord. The city in the kingdom to see old Jordan Road. Road, Jordan Road, Jordan Road, Jordan Road. Oh, I want to get to heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan Road.
Dear caller, allow those who are to lay the wreaths first to do so, and family and so forth. Jesus loved to hear little children saying, "We will come in the room."
Thank you. another planting. Good boy.
Amen.
He replaced Monica Deakin, who had been interim governor general after the death of Sir Charles Angelus. Today we remember him as a man of great humility as he is laid to rest.
Jordan Road, Road, Jordan Road, Road, Jordan Road, Jordan Road. Oh, I want you. Get to heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan roll. My brother, you ought to bend there. Yes, my Lord.
The late Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne, former Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Deakin, who had been interim Governor General after the death of Sir Charles Antrobus. Today we remember him as a man of great humility as he was laid to rest.
Jordan, roll. Oh, I want to get to heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan roll. My mother, you ought to bend down. Yes, my Lord. The city in the kingdom to see old Jordan roll. Jordan, Road, Jordan, Road, Jordan, Road. Oh, I want you to get to heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan roll. Oh, I want you to get to heaven when I die, to see old Jordan roll.
The late Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne, former Governor General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Deakin, who had been interim Governor General after the death of Sir Charles Antrobus. Today we remember him as a man of great humility as he is laid to rest.
Jordan Road, Road, Jordan Road, Road, Jordan Road, Jordan Road. Oh, I want you to get to heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan roll. My brother, you ought to bend there. Yes, my Lord.
The late Sir Frederick Nathaniel Ballantyne, former Governor-General of St. Vincent and the Grenadines, served from 2nd of September 2002. He replaced Monica Deakin, who had been interim Governor General after the death of Sir Charles Antrobus. Today we remember him as a man of great humility as he was laid to rest.
Road, Jordan, Road. Oh, I want to get to heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan roll. My mother, you ought to bend down. Yes, my Lord. The city in the kingdom to see old Jordan roll. Jordan, Road, to hear, O Jordan, roll. Oh, I want to get to heaven when I die, to see, O Jordan.